Okay, yeah. Thank you. Yes, I think I'm the first of a set of three presentations on DAO. Actually, this presentation was born as a sort of an introduction, an opinionated introduction, I'd say, to DAO, originally for a non-specialized audience. So this is a revised version, which is more on the opinionated side and less on the introduction side, because I guess that more or less everyone in the room already knows what DOH does. Still, I'd like to start by pointing out a few basic characteristics. Well, DOH, of course, is a DNS over GPS. It's a new standard. It's been released formally last October, so pretty new, even if people already started to implement it before it was even fully released. And the characteristics that I wanted to stress is that, first, it came mostly, not completely, but mostly, not from the DNS community, but from the web community. So people that make browsers, or also partly are from the same companies that operate the public resolvers. And you can see this, I mean, this will be part of the commentary. Of course, its aim is to transmit the DNS queries over an encrypted layer, which is achieved by using HTTPS as the transport protocol. And so it can be used pretty easily by any HTTPS speaking application. And this will be really one of the root issues that creates all the things we will be discussing. And the other interesting thing is that it requires you, I mean, to serve DOH, it requires you to have an upgraded DNS server. So you need to implement basically a web front end onto your traditional name server. But what you can also do is you can use an upgraded web server. And I think we're going to see some of these implementations possibly. So you can have a web server and add the DNS backend into it and have the web server serve the DNS content together with the HTTP content. So I tried to summarize, in my view, what are the three main effects of DOH coming onto the scene. And I've added some comments, because in the first version, there were some comments that I should really separate the protocol design issues from the deployment issues. So in the end, the first one, which is the immediate thing that you realize, is that now the DNS communication is encrypted. And in this case, it is also hidden inside web traffic. So encryption is also what you get with DNS over TLS. And that's the only thing that you also get with DNS over TNS over TLS. But in this case, you're all mixing the DNS traffic with the web traffic, up to a point that if the, as I was saying, the DNS server is incorporated within a bigger web server, then you will not be able to tell which of the traffic is DNS queries and which is normal web pages and other web content. And this is by design. This was one of the features that were explicitly mentioned as part of the protocol design. And the other design choice is to use basically an application layer protocol as the transport protocol. And this means that every application now can basically use a different resolver. You're moving DNS from the network service layer to the application layer. And this is really one of the things that, as we will see, has lots of consequences. And then the third one, which is what creates more concern into a lot of people, is not really a matter of design of the protocol, but it's a sort of a consequence of the first two in the way this is being deployed, and especially in the way this was being deployed in its initial deployment, which was by Mozilla and in Firefox. Which means that now, I mean, the application maker, and especially for the web, the browser makers, becomes the gatekeeper, the controller of the choice of the resolver which is being used to resolve the DNS queries made by the user. And so they have some abilities that they didn't have before. They can hardwire a resolver list, a single resolver as a default, or more than one resolver, and this has, again, some consequences. So before we start to get more into detail, basically an analysis of these three points, I just wanted to start with a note on terminology, because I mean, a part of the difficulty in this discussion is also that it's never been clear, even the words that we could use to identify what is happening. I mean, initially there was a lot of confusion on, I mean, which is the dichotomy that really defines the what is changing and what we should be focusing upon. I mean, some people were, again, discussing whether it's a matter of encryption, and as we will see, it's not, whether it's a matter of the business model of the people that now will run the resolvers, and partly, but I mean, in the end, also the DNS over cloud definition was proposed, but I don't think it's really a matter of cloud. So in my opinion, the real contrast that we see is between local resolution and remote resolution. And By local resolution, I mean when basically you're using, I mean you're the user, the final, basically average user, is using a resolver which is on their internet access provider's network, the ISP's network. So I mean, you basically immediately get to the resolver on the first hop, basically through your home router. And in this case, your resolution is local. It's not just local topologically, in the sense that it's on the first network that you have to traverse, I mean, to go wherever you want to go over the internet. It's also local in terms of relationships. Usually your ISP is, well, in your own country, usually even in your own city, you know them in some way, either you bought access online, or in many cases, you actually know them in person, you went to a physical shop or something like that. And so it's in your jurisdiction, it can speak to you in your language, and you already have a contractual relationship and a direct relationship with them. So you know how to get hold of them for whatever need you have. On the other hand, what we have increasingly been seeing is a remote resolution. So I call remote resolution anything which is not on the ISP's network. So whenever the resolver is outside of the ISP's network, somewhere over the internet, then this resolution becomes remote. And remote means that it's distant from you. Often, I mean, given the current state of the market for DNS resolution, if you're not from the United States, it's usually it's in a different country, because most of the services are at least legally provided by American companies. Maybe they are spread, and so you actually have a server in your own, near to you, but it's still topologically far away, and it's also far away in terms of contractual relationships. Actually, you don't have any firm contractual relationship. You're just using a service which is made available for free, unless, I mean, you're using one of the specific paid premium services like OpenDNS, and which is yet another case of remote resolution. So I will use this distinction throughout the discussion, but then now what I will do is that I want to go through the 3 points that I identified before. So let's start talking about the encryption of the DNS connection. This was meant to address basically this use case. So you're using a remote resolver somewhere over the internet, and since you have to go throughout a big number of hops, there are lots of opportunities for lots of people basically to intercept you, including your own ISP, by the way, but also other third, fourth parties, agencies, commercial parties, whatever, that can track your connection, since, I mean, traditionally your connection would not be encrypted. And since your connection includes a lot of personally identifiable information, it's highly relevant to build a profile of who you are and what you are doing basically over the internet, since everything you do starts with a DNS query. So this is the use case that is being addressed and actually solved by DOH. And this, however, is not really relevant if you're using a local resolver, because in this end, I mean, in this case, unless it's the ISP that is tracking you, which is one of the cases that I mentioned, it's much harder for someone to just intercept your queries. Your queries just do a very short hop between you and your ISP's network. So if your ISP is safe, then you're safe as well. But I think this is also the case that is being addressed, and this is also a source of concern. It's a case in which the ISP is basically proxying your queries. So even if you configure the remote resolver and you're thinking that you're sending your queries to Google or whoever, actually your ISP is checking what's going through. And there are good reasons for doing this, which may be actually, for example, filtering out malware and, I mean, stuff you really don't want to get to. There are reasons which maybe are not good or bad, but they are just required by law. So it might be a local law requiring the ISP to filter out stuff. There may actually be bad reasons for doing this, like profiling you and selling you out. But still, this is another case that DOH is addressing and is making impossible. So in the end, is this a good or bad thing? I think that it really depends on who you are. I mean, if you're using a local resolver, like still most of the people today, this is not really relevant in terms of attacks that you could be victim to, as long as you can trust your ISP. So this is actually good in the two cases. One, if you're using a remote resolver, and the other one is if you don't trust your ISP. And in both cases, DNS over HTTPS actually gives you something, gives you more privacy and more protection, and makes it easier for you to use the resolver you want. On the other hand, if you like the idea that your ISP is still checking whatever traffic you're sending around, then this is bad. But in the end, I think that this is mostly a good thing. So, I mean, if you're part of the DOH debate, I think that in the end, that there's not many people really complaining about the idea of encrypting DNS traffic. So the point of contention is not really about the encryption. It's rather about the other two things that are happening. So the second one, I mean, what happens if we start to having applications that each uses a different resolver? And again, this depends. Because, I mean, the argument that was used, and it's actually true in some cases, is that the user is not, I mean, the average user is maybe not so smart so that they can make a good choice of resolver. So they don't basically even know what a resolver is and what is happening. So if the application maker is really, of course it's more technical, so they know this much better than the average user. And if they really want to do something good for you, they can take care of the choice of resolver so that they pick a resolver for you which is providing you better service, including more privacy, for example. So in that case, so if the application is really doing in the interest of the user, then this can actually be good. And it's also good if you don't trust your operating system's implementation, which is now what is being used to send around your queries. And also if your implementation is not particularly good. And this is also one positive use case for DOH, since, I mean, for example, some JavaScript applications cannot really access all the DNS query types. And so by giving them direct access to the DNS, they can do more stuff. And there is one case in which this is really not relevant, which is, I think it's sort of the only possible middle ground between the, I mean, supporters and not so supporters of DOH, which is, in the end, if DOH applications use the, at least by default, the resolver which is configured in the operating system, then this is sort of neutralized, because in the end you will still have all the applications using the same resolver, and it would still be the resolver that has been configured by the user in the operating system. On the other hand, however, you still have a number of situations in which introducing this kind of differentiation in DNS queries at the application level is really problematic. And first is the case in which the application maker is dishonest. So it's not a browser maker, it's maybe a malware maker or someone that can, I mean, wants to direct DNS queries somewhere because it suits something bad that they want to do to you. And we've seen several examples of how DNS is being used to protect users, and this might go away. The other case is also if you're a smart user. So if you really are a user that wants to direct the DNS queries in some place, now you're starting to have problems. Because in the end, not all the applications might help you. So there are more and more cases in which this is creating problems. So first of all, at this point in time, again, this is more of a policy question maybe, but there's no guarantee that the applications will actually let you choose the resolver. So there might be applications that just start sending around DNS queries. And up to now, this was already possible, but it required implementing a full DNS stack into an application, which is not so simple. All that it takes now is basically having an HTTPS client, which is now what many applications have anyway. And there's also a problem if some of these, let's say, application connected resolvers start to fail. So what happens if they don't answer anymore for whatever problem? There's a problem if the application maker has different interests from the user, so wants to use this control to do stuff which is not really in the user's interest. But there's even more concerning scenarios. So what happens if we start having 10 different applications which are using 10 different resolvers and they get different responses for the same queries? This is going to create a real mess in the user experience. And it will be very hard for users to understand what's happening, and it will be very hard for other people to help the user and debug basically what's happening and understand what's going on. Even worse, what happens if applications start to actually control the namespace? Because some applications, we will see this in a minute, are much more concentrated. So if there is an application which is a dominant position over a specific application market, and they just start adding TLDs, modifying TLDs, removing TLDs, blocking, I mean, they can basically manage the namespace on their own. And it only takes an agreement among a small number of application makers to make this happen and basically bypass whatever policy process is in place to determine what happens to the DNS namespace. So I think that this was really a bad idea, but really a crossing the streams bad idea. So it's an architectural blunder in my view. So of course this is a personal opinion, but naming was meant to be a part of the overall network connectivity service. So it's something that helps to point your applications to somewhere so that you can use them. I don't think it's meant to be a separate application which interacts with the others and stays at an upper layer of the stack. So of course DNS is an application in itself, but still I think it would be better if it were kept as part of the overall network access problem. And so I'm wondering why, I would really be curious to have a discussion why this was done this way. I'm sure that maybe people will comment later. I see Warren, so I'm sure Warren knows and has ideas on this. So the third point is possibly the one where the discussion is open. This is really, I mean, connected to the deployments. I mean, all of these concerns, I think the real reason why we have been, I mean, discussing about the OIH at many, many conferences in the last, I'd say, 6 to 9 months, was the result of this announcement. This announcement is now 1 year old. This is what Mozilla put on their website at the end of May last year. And I mean, as I said, the standard was not really actually finally approved yet, but they were saying that they think this is good, and they've been the champions of this new standard, and they want to turn this on by default for all the users, which means that at a certain point in time, you bring up your Firefox and you get an update if you already have it, and it will start using another resolver, which is basically chosen by Mozilla, and not the resolver that you have configured in your operating system. And you will do this by default. So I'm sure that there will be some communication, like we are start to do this, please click on OK. But most users will not just understand what will be happening. Actually, Mozilla, I mean, they haven't done this yet. They have done a study in which they were basically telling users, we want to provide you better privacy in your DNS, so click OK if you agree. And of course, everyone clicked OK, and they started to send queries in parallel to the resolver that they had, which is, I mean, the CloudFlare's resolver. They have an agreement with CloudFlare for running this. And in parallel to that resolver, the DOH resolver, and to the traditional DNS resolver that was configured in their operating system. So even if, I mean, they have not been doing this yet, but also they have not changed their mind. So they continue saying that sooner or later this will happen. And so this is why there has been a lot of discussion. Some more, I mean, recent developments, if you want to see what's happening, let's say on the other side, let's say the website. Well, of course, Mozilla now has very recently released a draft resolver accreditation policy, which is a good thing. So the idea is that more resolver operators will be able to, I mean, accept the conditions that Mozilla is deciding and be on that list. And so at a certain point in time, it's unclear whether the browser will choose one among many, I mean, through random ways, or the user will pick, or, I mean, this is still unclear, but there will at least will be a list of accepted resolver in Firefox, which contains more than one element. But on the other hand, this is still an effort by Mozilla. So Mozilla is setting unilaterally the conditions that any resolver operator has to follow if they want to be usable in Firefox, at least in this future scenario in which they turn this on. And the other interesting thing, I mean, Bromite is a very, I mean, I think 20 people are using it. It's a Chromium derivative, super private on Android, so it's a browser. But it's interesting because these people possibly don't have a clue of all this discussion we're having. They just saw this DNS over HTTPS announcement and thought, this is cool, we want to give you more privacy. So this is what an average developer implements when they have to implement the DOH. And what they do is that they create a configuration screen, put the three biggest resolvers in it, and then that's the choice you get. So I think that we're going to see, especially in, not maybe in the big applications, but maybe in smaller applications, that this kind of configuration screen in which you get a limited number of pre-configured choices and that's it. So this is the real change, I think. It's, I mean, we come from a world in which the default, at least, was that you get the local resolution. So up to today, the default is that you connect to a network, you get whatever resolvers the local network is giving you. And that's the default. It's near to you, and it has all these characteristics of being local. But still, you can also change it. So, I mean, you can change your resolver if you feel that your local resolver is not good, or if you don't want to change your resolver every time you connect to a different network. You just go and configure whatever public resolver you want. And as we saw, I mean, data are now that more or less 1/3 of the people are using a public resolver, and 2/3 are using whatever local resolver they get. In the future, at least if the future happens with Mozilla's model, and Google up to now has a sort of different model. So, I mean, you're here, so I think you will comment. But so it's not to be given for granted that Mozilla's will be the only possible future. But still, if they insist in doing this and other browser makers follow, what you get is that basically by default, anyone downloads the browser, installs them, and gets the default resolver, which is a remote resolver, which has been chosen by the browser maker. And same for other applications, not just for browsers, though, of course, the web is the most important one. And even if you want to change that, the problem is now you have to change your resolver in each and every application. So for users, it becomes much harder to get control on where their DNS queries are going. And so what does this mean? I mean, in terms of policy, I think I'm even if I participate at the technical conferences, I'm the policy guy. So I see lots of consequences that still are not fully understood. So the first thing you get, and I think that most people are concerned about this one, is that, well, first you get new gatekeepers, so new entities that get to control where the DNS traffic goes. And as we were saying, I mean, DNS traffic is spread. Maybe hundreds of thousands is an overstatement, but we saw yesterday that to get the top 90-95% of the DNS resolutions, you have to go to the top 1,000 resolvers. While to get to 90% on the browser market, the four biggest browsers are enough. So the four biggest browser makers cover 90-90%, depending on the estimates of the market. And outside, if you take out China, it's even like 98% or something like that. And they are all in a single part of the world, in a single jurisdiction. So for people that are not from that jurisdiction, this is an additional concern. And also it becomes harder for users to do something differently, so to change these defaults, or at least it's not clear how can users manage this in the future. And then there was a discussion about privacy, because privacy is the motivation for encrypting the communication. And as I said, that there are a number of cases in which DOH gives you more privacy, which is good. And so it's actually good that your queries cannot be sniffed anymore. But the problem is that you're changing jurisdiction, as I was saying, in which, I mean, from a European point of view, it really gives you something less than in the past. I mean, most people in Europe feel that GDPR is the best privacy law that you can get at this point in time anywhere in the world. And so getting out of this and sending the data to entities which are not based in Europe is a problem. And also, I mean, today, if you get your DNS, it must be said, of course, that there is a commitment, especially in this initial phase, but I mean, Cloudflare and Mozilla has committed not to violate the privacy, delete the data, which is a pretty good privacy policy, and it's actually better than the privacy policy of many ISP-run servers. But at the same time, the web world has a business model which is much more based on monetizing data than the DNS and ISP world. So that's the long-term concern. These are companies that in the end profile people as a base of their main business generally. And so there is some long-term concern about this. And same for censorship. Again, censorship was another example. And because, I mean, several countries now, even in the West, in Europe, are using DNS based content filters, which are mandated by law to prevent people from connecting to different sorts of websites which are not acceptable according to local law. And okay, of course, if you direct, if you encrypt your traffic and mix it within web traffic and you send it somewhere else in the world, then you can bypass these filters. The problem is that now you get the filters in the resolver's country. So of course the resolver's country might have less filters, maybe at least at this point in time, but it's not like censorship is going away thanks to DOH. It's just switching the control point. And what we are worried about, especially what I'm worried about, is that countries, even democratic countries in Europe, might start mandating more intrusive ways of content filtering, such as IP address level filtering, as a response to that. So if DNS blocking, which is sort of a compromise, because everyone knows that users can easily bypass these kind of DNS blocks just by setting a public resolver. But since most users are not doing that, governments sort of accepted this, at least in Europe. And they said, okay, this works for most people. We don't want to be more intrusive onto the network. And so we're fine with this. But of course, if the default changes and now 95% of the people are getting bypassing these filters and getting a resolver somewhere else, I think there will be some response. And same for network neutrality. Again, this is just shifting the point where network neutrality can be broken and the people that can decide to do something to your DNS traffic to basically affect where you're going for whatever commercial reason they might have. Again, in terms of performance, this is more of a subject for researchers. So I mean, there are studies going on. But the fact that the resolver is remote, that doesn't necessarily mean that it works, it's slower. Actually, one of the reasons why many people use Google Resolver is that it's faster from where they are, because the ISP service, maybe it's a little bad. So this is also, ISPs should actually focus on making their DNS service work better if they don't. So this is also a call to action for the ISPs. There is an issue with CDNs, at least the CDNs that use DNS to direct people to the basically topologically better place where to get content, because of course, if you're using a local resolver, the CDN can assume, and the authoritative can assume that your local resolver identifies where you are. If you're using a remote resolver, you need to transmit at least the subnet of your IP address. And then either if you do it, this is a problem for privacy. And if you don't do it, you don't get the optimized source of the content. So this is also something which is still needs to be solved in the DOH world. And security. Security is really another big issue. There will be other people, I think, talking about it. But DNS is being increasingly used to block access to bad places you should not be able to connect to. And you have lots of security devices like Split Horizon, local names that rely on that to secure, especially corporate networks. And this is going away. And finally, the issue is really also about users. So, I mean, everyone says we are doing this for the users, and partly this is true. But today, actually, users can do a lot of things that become at least not working anymore in the old way in the future DOH world, especially their ability to change the DNS server to get additional DNS services like parental control. Or simply to choose where the DNS queries go. I mean, this will be harder to do unless there is some kind of agreement that we should still provide users with the capability to control where their DNS queries are. And also in terms of expectations, more or less there's a 20-year-old history telling users how DNS works this way, and now this is changing, and so there's a lot of education to be done. So, I mean, these are the three key points that I wanted to distill from this. That, I mean, it's nice to have privacy in transport, but it's just a small part of what privacy is in the total. So when we discuss privacy, we have to discuss everything and not just encrypting the transport. That potentially you're creating surveillance points if you're concentrating traffic, and at the same time you're taking away opportunities for users to control what's happening. And also that it would be nice to have freedom, but changing the entity which is in charge of something, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to get more freedom. Also, it doesn't mean that you'll get less, but it's a conceptually different thing. And so in the end, is this good or bad? I mean, there are several cases. It's still good if you are, for example, if you're the traditional dissident, you will see lots of presentations with Quad 8 pictured on a wall in Turkey. And in the end, it's a matter of trust. It depends whether you trust more the big internet platforms or your ISP. It's a problem, at least if you're not from the US, if you trust more, I mean, having your DNS queries under another jurisdiction on your own. And so it really depends. But I still think this is bad unless we have appropriate policies. So my conclusion is that there really is a policy discussion to have. At least if we have it, then it might actually be a good thing, but we need to have it. And so I close with the dilemma. Originally it was one. So I think there's not an agreement on who should be the person or the entity choosing which you are using. And there needs to be an agreement on this. But now there are more. So there's a discussion to have on who should be entitled to apply policies to your DNS and decide if queries have to be altered. Is the government, is the resolver, the administrator? And finally, where do we have the discussion? So there's a lot of work to do, and this is the to-do list, so I will not go through it. But the message is that I think there needs to be more discussion before we proceed with this. Thank you.